Today, our guest on My Story is an educationist, a philanthropist, an art enthusiast who has been actively involved in the development of women and children. She's a founder of Witty Kids School, a co-educational secondary school located in Maraba, Nasarawa State. A Witty Kids Helping Hands Foundation that empowers orphans and the less privileged in the society.
Henrietta, Meepatan, Abu. I'm from Delta State. I'm married to Abu Meepatan. Well, I would say growing up was not really fun in the sense that we were eight in the family, and the money was not really there. So it's like, even as a child, you don't really have your childhood because you also have to start working to meet ends meet. And at the same time, it's not like our days where you have house helps. I had seven siblings. So I didn't grow up as a child. I grew up as an adult. You know, as early as 11, I could go to the market, you know, shop, come home, I cook for the whole family of 10 at that tender age. Then in our neighborhood, at a point we had a problem with water, so I had to trek long distance after school to make sure there's water available in the house. And you know, you do this with a big bowl, you trek. I grew up in Zaria. We are staying close to the barracks, but they had water in the barracks, so we trek from our house like a kilometer distance. You trek to go and fetch this water and make sure all the drums in the house are, you know, filled up. So apart from that, I was born doing the whole laundry for the family. Like on a Saturday, while other kids my age are playing, from morning till 4, I will be involved in doing the laundry for the house. When our kids are faced with a difficult upbringing, especially economically, you know, the first contact a child has is the home, is the parents. And you know, in most cases, it's not even our fault as parents that we cannot provide ends meet for our kids. Sometimes you try and it doesn't just work out. But as a parent, I think what you do is that, and I know that's what my parents were doing then, although they didn't have much. But you know, the little they have, they give you with love. You understand? And you know, they always give you that hope. They always tell you that, my daughter, don't worry. This, I know this is, you deserve more than this, but let's keep praying and let's keep working hard. Because then the future, you understand, it will be bright. So it's like, even when you're going through that difficulties, you are not going through it alone. When I entered the university, I knew, one, that I had other seven siblings, and then the money was not forthcoming. So I knew at that point that I needed to look for a way to support myself, because they were trying all they could. So I just, on my own, I felt, and I also attributed that to the upbringing, because I didn't say, okay, since I'm not an undergraduate, I will go and get a man that will be funding me. No, because of the moral aspects of, you know, growing up. So what I did then, I had one of my aunts was in Kaduna. She had a restaurant. She's now late. May her soul rest in peace. So what I do then was that during the holidays, and you know then holidays were like long. During the long holidays, I go to her shop, and then I serve people in the restaurant. I wash the dishes. Then sometimes I act as the cashier. So by the time I'm doing that, when I'm going back to school, obviously she pays me and she, you know, she gives me food stuff. So to complement what my parents were providing. So even in school, nobody knew, because I was not like begging. I was to some extent okay. So nobody knew how I was surviving. But that is what really helped me, because during the holiday, I'm in the shop. So that was how I helped them to help me through the university system. So I also, in my day-to-day life, you know, I come across some young people and I advise them that lack or poverty. Because if there's anything you want to tell me about lack or poverty, I know. I've stayed without eating. I've lived without having clothes or, you know, as a young girl. But then I never went astray. Instead, I used my strength, you understand, what I have, not in a negative way, to help myself. So when I meet young people, I advise them that don't always use poverty as an excuse to prostitute or to steal. It is not. Because don't be ashamed. I wasn't ashamed then. I go to the restaurant to work. Some of my classmates, even when they see me doing that, obviously they might even laugh at me. But I didn't care, because I know it was a honest means of livelihood. So when you are in school and you see yourself in that kind of situation, try to be inventful, you understand? Don't just sit like that, because once you sit like that and you are hungry, the next thing you will be attracted to, you know, to go into other vices. So try to look for something. Even then on campus, you see students, you know, selling in the hostel. Some that are good in making hair, they make hair just to, you know, to support themselves. This is my story.
Please tell us a story.
In the locality, I become a local champion there, that if they come to the shop, they didn't see me, nobody could make her hair.
I want to be a lawyer in the future by the grace of God.
My life is a testimony. Follow me, the tango.
During my own time, from my story, I could be referred to as the house help in my house.
My name is Onu Blessing, and I would like to become a lawyer in future.
I want to become a mechanical engineer in future.
My name is Ramota Adebi, and I am 9 years old. I want to be a lawyer in the future by the grace of God.
The only thing that can make me not to be an accountant is not going to school.
The only thing that can make me not to become an engineer in future is if I don't go to school and get good education.
Baba God bless you, no go pass you by. He go bless you, so tell them go ask you.
Your kada, you know what I say. Go drive home, I need everybody to sell your water. You know I say I like the full gutter, but I'm still a plant and vine. I'm really making my
life.
A difficult childhood can prevent you from being what you want to become in life. Instead, I believe it should be a motivation for you to succeed in life. Because from my own story, I was not born with a silver spoon. And when I was growing up, of course, life was not a bed of roses for me. So, you know, I always had it in mind that I need to, you understand, work hard because I want my tomorrow to be better. So it was like a force. The difficulties or the poverty then was like a force that was pushing me towards hard work and towards a positive direction. Because I had that dream that when I become something later in life, I don't want my children to go through the same thing I went through. I wanted to be a better person. So, but you know, these days, the problem we have, the difference between these days and those days is that the teenagers we have these days growing up, they don't want to work hard. They don't know that success is by steps. You take steps. You need to work hard to attain what you want to get in life. You don't just wake up one morning and you start wishing and things will happen. So if you want to be successful in life and you are a student, you need to, no matter what you are going through, you need to study very hard for you to be successful and for you to become something in life. So I don't think challenges should discourage you from being what you want to be in life. Rather, I think challenges should be a driving force that when you wake up in the morning, you don't have food to eat, you don't have the luxury of life. Then you know the reality will hit you that the only way I can do this is to work hard so that my tomorrow will be better. If I have that opportunity again to relive my early childhood, I don't think I want to change anything because I still prefer how I grew up to what I'm seeing around me today. You know, there are a lot of things we see today that our youth are involved in that then it was not like that. For example, when we talk about social media today, during my time, there was no social media. So I could read. You could study. You were just interested in, you know, in reading and studying. And when you read and study, you acquire knowledge. And it is knowledge that will propel you to succeed in life. So, but you see the things of today, what do they do? The reading culture is no longer there. The only thing they do every time they are on the internet, you know, going through what they are not supposed to go through, and their minds are polluted. In our days, it was not like that. We didn't have access to all these things. So our minds were not polluted. And apart from that, like the moral values I had then, I don't think I will have it now. Because then we have good moral values. As a young girl, I know I'm supposed to, you know, keep myself. I know that no matter what I'm going through, I shouldn't be on the streets. You understand? I shouldn't be going from one man to the other just because I want to succeed. We had those moral values then, that even when, I know when I was in secondary school, if you are caught having a male friend, a boyfriend, you go through a lot, you can even be expelled from the school. But today is not like that. So I wouldn't want to trade my childhood for what is happening now. Raising kids these days is very difficult because of one, you have a peer group. The peer group these days make it very difficult for you to raise a child. You also have the social media, which is a very, I'm not saying that the social media is a bad thing. I'm not saying that, but when kids are exposed to it unsupervised at an early age, it has negative impact on the kids. And even the television they view, you know, and most of the channels they view are not even our channels. They are foreign channels. And the culture they watch, the culture they are exposed to, and our own African culture, there is a big difference. That's where the difficulty in parenting come in this generation. Because in our generation, we are not exposed to all those stuffs. And the other aspect, again, is most of us, most young people of this generation, we have house help in the house. And, you know, there's always a misconception. Because you think you have a house help, The housewife wakes up in the morning. Like during my own time from my story, I could be referred to as the housewife in my house. But in a way, my parents were preparing me for the future to be a good mother, a good housewife, and a good business person. But in our days today, these are some of the mistakes we make in parenting, and that's why parenting is difficult. Because when you have a housewife in the housewife wake up very early when your kids are still sleeping. In my days, I wake up as early as 4 o'clock, and I don't see anything bad in it because I need to wake up by 4 to make sure I cook, clean, and I trek to school. There was no school bus, so I need to wake up early. I know it's my responsibility. Nobody needs to wake me up. When is that 4 o'clock? I'm up. But these days we have our house help. Your kids will be sleeping, they will be up. They will be the one doing all the chores in the house. At the end of the day, you think it's luxury. It's not luxury. You're training the house help and you're not training your child. And you think it's luxury. It's not luxury. You're not helping that child. So that's why you discover that most times when you talk, the kids we have these days, when you talk to them, I have a son that is almost 12. I would say is even if being a strict parent, it's still difficult. Because in my time, my parents don't even need to talk. They have this sign language. They use their eyes, they use their nose. There's a way they will look at you and you just know that. You know, I have to do something. But you know, raising my child is difficult because he feels he has a right. So it's like, when I talk, he talk back. When I say do this, he wants to give me a reason why he's not supposed to do that. And I know those ideas are from what he's, you know, watching. He's watching the tradition and the culture of a different society. That is different from my own, because as an African, when you talk to a child, the child is not supposed to, you know, talk back at you. You know, he always wants to tell you, mommy, this is why I shouldn't do this. Or somebody is in my school is not doing this. You understand? But even with that, as a parent, you need to be firm. Because at this age, I'm still the one in charge. I'm the one in control, so I need to put my feet down. When I say do this, you do this. When you talk back at me, then I deal with you in my own way. So for me as a mom, and I always make sure I talk to him. We talk. At times I call him and I want to hear his views. And I also try to tell him, this is why I want you to do this. This is why, even if we have a house help in the house, a domestic staff, this is why I want you to do this, because I'm preparing you to be a better person tomorrow. Like my son will be 12 by November, but at least when he wakes up in the morning, I tell him to come out and wash my car for me. Although at first he resists, but I make sure I enforce it. And now he's having fun washing the cars. And then he also clean up his room. So there are some chores that I've given to him that when you wake up in the morning, after your morning devotion, after praying, these are things that need to be done before you can, you know, have fun for the day. And also when it comes to studying, we need to be very firm as parents, because unlike our days, we didn't have all this distraction. But these kids of these days, they have all this distraction. And we as parents, we paid and we kept all this distraction in our houses. So we need to look for a way to, like, a check and balance. Okay, this is the time that you study. Okay, this is the time that you can play your PS4 or whatever. I'm a product of spanking and I'm not regretting it. I don't wake up in the morning and I say I was abused by my parents. I was not abused. They spanked me, they disciplined me, and I turned out to be a good person. So I'm not against spanking. If my child misbehaves, I give him a good spanking. But the difference is that after the spanking, I will call him and I will tell him, this is why I did this to you. don't try it next time, because if you do it next time, it will be fine too. And I will also ask of his opinion about it. I got married in 2003, came to Abuja because I felt Abuja was just the ultimate, you understand. I read urban and regional planning. I finished from AB Usaria. It was very difficult for me to get a job. Then finally we got a house somewhere and there was a BQ. And the BQ was empty, and I started thinking, because naturally I'm good with children. So I started thinking, what about if I should start a daycare here? So that was how I started Witty Kids School. I just started with a child in the daycare. But my dreams were there. I was not, even when people, when I tell people, they'll be like, you don't have a land, you don't have this. And I'm like, okay, I will just start then. You know, sometimes when you start, God will take you to the next level. So that was what happened in my case. I just started by faith with what I had in that same environment, because most time the environment that I was there, you know, people move from that environment to town. But you know, sometimes your blessings might be hidden in that environment that you are not regarding. So that was how I started, and God is, it's not as if we have reached where we are supposed to be, but God has been faithful. God has been, you know, helping. I also try to tell youth that instead of just waiting for government opportunity, try to be creative. Try to look inward. What is it that I can do? You understand? In where I am today, this situation I am today, what can I do? And you know, most times when you start from the scratch, you can hardly fall, because you know what you've gone through. You understand? You know, this is something I built from the scratch. So you put everything into it. You don't want it to, you don't want it to go wrong. You want to get it right. So it's the same story with my husband. My husband, Abu Meepatan, is also an inspiring story, because he also started from a very humble background, but he's, if there's any man that is hardworking, he's the one. He is hardworking and he has this passion to succeed. You know, when you are hardworking and you have this passion to succeed and you're honest and God is on your side, honestly, there's nothing you cannot achieve as an individual. I just want to encourage our young ones that, not minding what is happening presently in the country, we should still be patriotic. We should still speak positively. Because for me, I don't have any other country. Surprisingly, I will tell you this. Even if I'm given a green card today to go and relocate to the US, I won't go. I only go there on vacations, you understand? Nigeria is my country. This is the only country I have. So no matter what is going on, when I wake up every morning, I still pray. I don't want to speak anything negative. I want to be very positive. You understand? So everything I say about this country, I try to make sure it's positive, because I don't have anywhere to go to. And I want this country to be a better place for my children and for my grandchildren. I want it to be, I want my kids to grow up and be proud that they are Nigerians. Because even with the situation, anywhere I go to over the world, I'm proud to be a Nigerian. I don't hide it. So we encourage our youth to be patriotic. When you are patriotic towards something, you have passion. Even if that thing is going bad, because you have passion for that particular thing, you want to make that thing to be better. So I will advise every youth, every adult out there that even in these difficult times, I'm not a politician, but we know so much is going on in this country that we are not happy about. But we don't have any other place to call home. This is our home. So we should try to put our hands together and shun, you know, corruption and shun everything that will not portray Nigerian as the giants of Africa.
And that's it on My Story today. For your comments and suggestions, please send a text or WhatsApp message to 0806-004-2843. Thank you for staying tuned.